Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Johnson. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Wednesday, the 11th of August. Rain-triggered floods ravaged residential areas in India's Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. Taliban take 8 provincial capital in speedy advance across Afghanistan. And Bangladesh lifts lockdown as COVID-19 cases trajectory falls. And now for all the details. Floods triggered by heavy rainfall continue to cripple normal life in parts of India's eastern Bihar and northern Uttar Pradesh states on Wednesday, inundating several low-lying residential areas. Meanwhile, a landslide hit Kinnaur district in the hilly state of Himachal Pradesh on Wednesday, trapping around 40 people. At least 2 people were confirmed dead and the toll was likely to rise as rescue operations were still underway till the last reports came in.
Rain-triggered floods, which have inundated several villages in parts of India's eastern Bihar state, continue to cripple normal life on Wednesday, causing major trouble to locals. The river Ganges has crossed the danger mark in Bihar, leading to hundreds of villages being submerged in districts including Patna, Bhagalpur and Katihar. The flood situation has forced people to shift to safer places. Seasonal monsoon rains are crucial for farmers, but excessive rainfalls affect several regions in India every year, as civic administrations often fail to cope with challenges posed by them.
Pura gaon dub gaya. Parshani bahut hai. Kapda bhija bhija ke aate hain, itna dur naav se paar hote hain. Kaise sote
the? Similar scenes were witnessed in parts of India's northern Uttar Pradesh state, as water level of Yamuna and Ganges rivers has increased substantially following incessant rainfall in recent days. Meanwhile, rescue operations were underway to find around 40 people who were feared trapped after a landslide hit Kinnaur district of northern Himachal Pradesh state. Around 10 people had been rescued and at least 2 persons were confirmed dead till the last reports came in.
Taliban fighters have captured 2 more cities in Afghanistan, taking the number of provincial capitals the group has seized to 8 in 6 days, as US-led foreign forces complete their withdrawal. The capture of Faizabad, capital of northeastern province of Badakhshan, came as President Ashraf Ghani arrived in Mazar-e-Sharif city to rally old warlords to the defense of the biggest city in the north as Taliban forces close in.
Taliban fighters took control of another city in northern Afghanistan on Wednesday, an official said, the 8th provincial capital out of country's 34 provincial capitals to fall to the insurgents in 6 days as US-led foreign forces complete their withdrawal. The Taliban capture of Faizabad, capital of the northeastern province of Badakhshan, came as President Ashraf Ghani landed in Mazar-e-Sharif to rally its defenders as Taliban forces closed in on the biggest city in the north. Javed Mojaddedi, a provincial council member from Badakhshan, said the Taliban had laid siege to Faizabad before launching an offensive on Tuesday. The Taliban are battling to defeat the US-backed government and reimpose strict Islamic law. The speed of their advance has shocked the government and its allies. US President Joe Biden urged Afghan leaders to fight for their homeland, saying on Tuesday he did not regret his decision to withdraw, noting that the United States had spent over $1 trillion over 20 years and lost thousands of troops. Afghan officials have appealed for pressure on Pakistan to stop Taliban reinforcements and supplies flowing over the border. Pakistan denies backing the Taliban. Meanwhile, the multilateral meeting on the peace process in Afghanistan convened Tuesday in Qatar's capital of Doha, with participating parties calling for a political settlement to achieve enduring peace in the country. The meeting called for agreements on fundamental issues reached by all sides in a timely manner to jointly promote peace and stability in Afghanistan and ultimately achieve a permanent and comprehensive ceasefire and form an inclusive government in the country.
In news from Pakistan, Pakistan People's Party Chairman Bilawal Bhutto Zardari has always denounced Prime Minister Imran Khan's government on its inability to function efficiently. In a press conference in Karachi city on Tuesday, Bilawal called Khan's government unstable and that the general elections could be held in the country at any time. Pakistan People's Party PPP Chairman Bilawal Bhutto Zardari said on Tuesday that Prime Minister Imran Khan's Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf government is unstable and that the general elections could be held in the country at any time. Speaking at a press conference in Karachi, Bilawal said that fresh elections were the only solution to the problems facing the country. He reiterated calls for opposition to mount no-trust bids against PM Imran Khan and Sindh Province Chief Minister Usman Buzdar.
तरफ आ रहे हैं, जहाँ तक elections की बात है, ये बहुत unstable हुकूमत है, illegitimate तो हुकूमत है ही, लेकिन ये बहुत ही unstable है, और हम समझते हैं कि किसी भी वक्त आम इंतखाबात हो सकते हैं और यही वजह है कि हम अपनी तैयारी कर रहे हैं.
Bilawal criticized the federal government for depriving Sindh province of funds and said that it is unhappy because of the work the PPP is doing for Karachi day and night. He expressed his regret saying that Prime Minister has a lenient attitude towards terrorists. He had earlier termed Khan as puppet and ineligible Prime Minister. Moving on, scores of locals recently blocked a key highway in Gilgit-Baltistan over years of water crisis in the illegally occupied region, which has aggravated in the aftermath of recent flash floods. They blamed administrative apathy for their plight and lamented Islamabad does not consider them at par with citizens of Pakistan.
Scores of locals blocked a key highway in Gilgit-Baltistan recently to demand the authorities to pay attention to the years of water crisis, which has only aggravated in the aftermath of the massive floods that wreaked havoc in the illegally occupied region in recent weeks. The protesters claimed an increasing water demand is being managed by supplying a mixture of clean water and sewage. They said even the courts that anyway offer little hope for justice have proved inefficient in the years of their fight to receive what is absolutely essential to human survival.
पानी जो गटर का पानी हमारे साफ पानी में मिक्स हो जाता है, जिसकी वजह से बीमारियां बहुत सारे अमवात भी हो चुके हैं, बीमार भी हैं। सबसे ज्यादा रेशो गणेश कला की जो आबादी 800 घरों में मौजूद थे, हर दफा हमने एहतजाज किया, एफआईआर कटे, अदालतों में गए, 8 साल तक एफआईआर के जो है वक्त में हम रगड़ खाते रहे, कोई सोल्यूशन नहीं निकला.
The protesters said the flash floods in the region after heavy monsoon rains destroyed several water channels and damaged homes and property, and they were left to fend for themselves with no relief from the government. Lack of basic amenities has always been an issue of concern in Gilgit-Baltistan, but the locals accuse that the stooge government that works at Islamabad's behest has always ignored their plight, as they are not considered at par with citizens of Pakistan.
In news from Sri Lanka, former Sri Lankan minister and parliamentarian Rishad Bathuideen, who was arrested and detained by the Criminal Investigation Department in connection with a case related to the 2019 Easter Sunday attacks, has been remanded until 18th of August. Bathuideen has been in detention under the Prevention of Terrorism Act on charges of aiding and abetting the Easter Sunday attackers since April 24. Investigations are underway into the issuance of a license to the copper factory of Inshaf Ahmed, the bomber who carried out the suicide bombing at the Cinnamon Grand Hotel on Easter Sunday, while Rishad was a minister. The magistrate then ordered that Rishad be remanded until the end of trial regarding the Cinnamon Grand bomber who owned the copper factory. The case is set to return to court on the 18th of this month. On 21st April 2019, nine suicide bombers carried out a series of attacks on three churches, three luxury hotels and guest house and residential area across Sri Lanka, killing more than 290 people and injuring nearly 500. Moving on to news from Bangladesh. Bangladesh on Wednesday lifted a weeks-long nationwide lockdown owing to significant drop in COVID-19 infections in recent days. The government had enforced a strict lockdown on July 1 due to the virus resurgence that has put immense pressure on the healthcare system.
Life returned to normal in Bangladeshi capital Dhaka as the government lifted weeks-long strict lockdown imposed in July, substantially easing COVID-19 curbs from Wednesday. As per the guidelines, almost all factories, offices, markets and shops have been allowed to open from 10 a.m. to 8 p.m., while hotels and restaurants can stay open from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. Buses, trains and river vessels have also been allowed to carry passengers half of their seating capacity. Bangladesh recorded 11,164 new cases in the last 24 hours, taking the nationwide tally to 1,376,322 as of Wednesday. Meanwhile, Bangladesh kicked off a vaccination drive on Tuesday for thousands of Rohingya Muslim refugees at Cox's Bazar, the world's largest refugee settlement, amid a surge in infections there. A health official said those aged 55 and above will be getting their shots first. Refugees at the camp expressed satisfaction over the beginning of the vaccination campaign for them. Aid workers have long warned of a potential humanitarian disaster if there is a significant outbreak in the refugee camps in Cox's Bazar, where over a million Rohingya reside after fleeing a military crackdown in Myanmar in 2017. Around 20,000 cases and 200 deaths have been recorded among the refugees since the pandemic erupted last year.
More news from Bangladesh. Harvesting of jute plants is getting momentum in Bangladesh. Jute, dubbed as golden fiber, is a major source of livelihood for people in rural Bangladesh. Farmers in Bangladesh's Manikganj district, some 40 miles northwest of capital Dhaka, are now busy harvesting jute plants. They dry jute after husking the fibers from the plants. The wholesale market, there is also a buzz with buyers and sellers. The cash crop experienced a sharp decline in demand over the past decades due to plastic products. It has been struggling to get back its past glory in the recent years as eco-concerns drive demand for biodegradable bags on both the local and foreign markets. This has encouraged more farmers in Bangladesh to return to their family trade. An orchardist in India's Jammu and Kashmir territory has grown world-famous dragon fruit in his field, garnering attraction from locals. The dragon fruit orchard is the first in the Kashmir Valley and is also generating employment for some local youth.
An orchardist hailing from Kathua district of India's Jammu and Kashmir has grown world-famous dragon fruit in his field, garnering attraction from locals in the Union Territory. Deepak Gupta, who belongs to a family of businessmen, decided to do something different in the horticulture sector. A self-proclaimed nature lover, Gupta set up an orchard and planted a number of dragon fruit plants last year as an experiment with an estimated cost of nearly $13,430. The dragon fruit orchard is the first in Kashmir Valley. Otherwise, the fruit, which is native to the America, is imported from other states and countries. The orchard is also generating employment for some local youth.
The fruits mein sabse bada antioxidant hai. डायबिटीज के पेशेंट्स के लिए काफी अच्छा है ये फ्रूट हमारे यहाँ पे लोग काफी डिमांड कर रहे हैं जो डायबिटीज के पेशेंट्स हैं वो हमें काफी लोग फार्म पे डायरेक्ट आ रहे हैं अप्रोच कर रहे हैं कि हमें दीजिए क्योंकि ये मार्केट में इतनी अच्छी क्वालिटी का जो इंपोर्टेड आ रहा है जो रेगुलर मार्केट में मिल रहा है उसकी क्वालिटी इतनी अच्छी नहीं है
Gupta explained the plantation of the fiber and mineral-rich fruit is different from other fruits as pillars are used in this process and it slowly grows like creepers. He also appealed to youths to come forward and establish farms of dragon fruit to boost their income.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now, our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/isasianewsline and follow us on Twitter @isasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.